Okay, it's 7 o'clock, February 16th. We're going to call the Conway Board of Selectmen meeting to order. First item on the agenda is minutes for February 1st and February the 8th. Has everybody seen the minutes?
Yes.
Any additions or amendments to either the minutes of the 1st or the minutes of the 8th?
No, they're pretty good.
All right, I'll make a motion that we accept the minutes for the select board meetings for February 1 and February 8. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Okay, meetings attended by select board members since last meeting?
I didn't know. Since then.
Okay. Citizens' concerns?
Well, I have one, I guess, that come under citizens and select boards. Because of the town's vote and most of our neighboring towns and the majority of the folks in them, the Department of Energy seems to be weighing in now on the pipeline business and claiming that it's needed, but they've also apparently approved export of the gas when it gets this far. So 50% of it might be exported somewhere else, and I'm very concerned about that. Because if everybody goes the way they want to go in our federal agencies and this passes, then they, our DPU says it's okay for them to survey and on private land, even though people don't like it or disapprove of it. We will have land being taken by eminent domain to enrich somebody by shipping U.S. resources to Europe. And I think that should be a big concern for all of us, that the government agencies seem to be in favor, which shouldn't be an unusual thing, in favor of very, very wealthy corporations, sounds like Bernie Sanders, so that they can have their way, no matter what it does here. And as I read somewhere, there's like a 10 to 20 year timeline on all of this that the energy industry is making an effort to suck everything it can suck out of the ground and sell it before it's all run out, no matter what kind of damage they do. And I think that's a big concern. But I think it should concern all of us that our state and federal agencies that have anything to do with the energy industry seem to be dismissing alternatives and standing in the way. And I just read an article, Florida, the Sunshine State, is being told it doesn't have enough sunshine for solar industry. And there's a, Kinder Morgan is also building a pipeline across pristine land and protected land and wetland and whatever in Georgia to get more and more of the of gas energy into Florida. And the Florida state government is putting roadblocks up to keep people from having solar. In a state that's, what, about 6 or 7 times the size of Massachusetts, with a population about 3 times the size of the numbers in Massachusetts, and they only have about 7,000 or 8,000 solar systems in the whole state.
Hmm. Interesting.
In Florida.
Okay.
But I think that's a big concern.
Okay. Thank you, Jim.
Yep.
Any other citizens' concerns? Ryan?
Well, back here again. I guess I'm a little upset with the way the roads were, again, treated this storm. I see that they were out plowing Monday night, the blacktop roads. Never touched the dirt roads Monday night. This morning they went out, plowed all the blacktop roads, salted them. They were beautiful. Never touched the dirt roads. Never had a bit of sand on my road till after 12 o'clock noon. people have to go to work in this town first thing in the morning. My wife has to leave 6 o'clock in the morning. I expect Boyden Road and Graves Road tomorrow morning sanded to the hilt by 6 a.m. Not this 12 o'clock noon anymore. I should have, or we should have, the same rights as everybody on the blacktop roads. My dirt roads, or all the dirt roads in this town, should be treated just as well as all the blacktop roads in this town. And I want to know why they're not. I got a road boss that wants more toys so that he can supposedly do his job better. He wants more toys, yet he can't even take care of the roads in this town. This is getting to be ridiculous. I come down here every meeting and complain about my road not being taken care of whatsoever. What are we going to do? She called this.
Well, I have a vehicle. I don't have four-wheel drive, okay? The storm before this one, I was coming home on Graves Road because it's flatter to get to my house versus going up Boyden Road. Okay, mm-hmm. Graves Road, when I got to the area, you got Gary Leshefsky's house, and then you go up, and then there's the pond, and then there's this little curve mm-hmm. like this. Now, there were two cars off the road there. I couldn't get by. Okay, the road wasn't plowed well, wasn't sanded. I had to back all the way up. My car, thankfully, nobody came up behind me. I had to back all the way up to that ranch that's just after Gary's house on the flats. Okay, yeah. I mean, so, and that is the storm before that one, where the roads weren't taken care of. They weren't taken care of again. I didn't have to go to work today, thankfully. I could take the day off because I was concerned about going. I mean, I have to drive to Springfield every day. I have to leave early, especially when the roads are not so well. And I mean, to me, I pay a lot in taxes, and the roads are lousy. In the summertime, they're all potholes. In the winter, they don't even get plowed. They don't even get sanded. And I don't understand why, and I'd like to have some answers. Then when I call, if I was to call this office, I can't speak to anyone. There's no one that answers the phone. I don't need to speak to someone 2 days from now when the issue has gone away and the sun's shining and the roads are perfect. And it seems ludicrous to even talk about the issue. But the fact is that I pay a lot of taxes, and the fact is that it's being ignored. And I don't care what other people say, oh, you know, it's not so bad. If you have the post people go by and they say it's not that bad. I live on the road every day. Try going there every day, back and forth on the roads the way they are, and I think you'd see a big difference.
On a vehicle that you own, not that the government owns.
Right.
Well, as I said, when I was still delivering the mail in the postal vehicle.
And I'm really sick and tired of hearing this whole story. I've heard it 10 times.
Okay? Yeah, I know you have. I've heard yours too 10 times.
Right. So it's about time that the dirt roads started getting taken care of the way they should be taken care of.
Do you have anything to say about that, Bob?
All right. Tom, would you look into that with Ron?
I have a call in.
Okay.
I didn't hear back from him.
Okay.
I have not heard back from him.
Do we have
no
other
information to give?
We have any other complaints on the dirt roads?
There was one on North Field Road today.
The one
that comes in from Ashfield.
No, it's South Ashfield Road.
Jones. What is it?
Jones Corner Road.
Okay.
That's over Shelburne.
That was also problematic today.
Okay. Let's have Ron pay special attention to Graves and Boyden.
By 6 a.m.
Early.
Why don't we just get him in and discuss how much serious this matter is and then needs to be taken care of.
Let's see if we can do it this way first.
And I mean, they sanded my road today. Mm-hmm. And as I said before, you might as well have gone out there with a 5-gallon pail and a teaspoon and thrown it out there. I want it sanded.
Understand why they didn't plow the roads this morning, the dirt roads. And if I was superintendent, I'd have done the same thing because of a heavy rain coming. Because if you plow those roads off early, the rains came, they're going to be like the top of this table.
Well.
But they did need to get out there and put sand on, but evidently they didn't get out there until, what you said, new time?
After 12 o'clock, finally came through. So.
Unfortunately, in a small storm like this, we haven't got a lot of snow, and you got a lot of rain right behind it. The only thing you really can do to the dirt roads is sand them, but sand them very well.
Thank you.
And last year, I couldn't, it was on a weekend, I couldn't come home. I'd stay at my mother's house until like 7 o'clock at night when the roads finally got sanded. They didn't get sanded all day. And I had left early in the morning, and because they weren't taken care of, I had to find some place to stay to the evening till he calls me and says it's safe to come home. I mean, that's a little crazy that I cannot come home any time throughout the day because the dirt roads are not being taken care of. But I can go to any one of these hardtop roads and it's fine. I mean, it's to me inappropriate. I pay just as much tax per $1,000 as everybody in this room.
All right,
so
we'll,
I'd like to know
we'll
why.
Talk,
I can't
we'll talk to Ron about it.
I appreciate it.
Okay. Thanks for coming in.
Thank you.
Well, one more thing. I want to know, every time I call down here and talk to Tom, does that message get to you people? Because I've called numerous times and complained, and I want to know, does he write down every time a citizen calls in and complains, the date, the time, who the citizen is, does he write that down and then turn it over to you? Because you are the people who are supposed to take care of this town, not Tom. All does right. he do
we'll,
that?
We'll discuss that with Tom.
I'm asking a question. Can,
yeah.
I, can I get an
we'll
answer?
We'll discuss it with Tom.
I can't get an answer.
Not right now. No.
So in other words, my answer is no.
No,
that's
your answer is we'll discuss
that's
it
what
with
I
Tom.
Thank you. By 6 in the morning.
All right, Tom, fiscal 2016 budget.
That's going to be a little bit involved, and we do have the two guests. I would suggest talking with Gemma first.
Okay.
And Dana's come in.
Gemma, please.
Terrible night.
Have a seat.
Well.
Come on up to the.
Oh, yeah. I get a big person here?
We get a big person.
Oh,
thanks for coming in.
Yeah. Thank you. See you again.
Okay. Yeah. And thank you for the service you've given. So, Gemma. The selection committee for ambulance director has recommended you for the position. And based on that recommendation, I want to move that we offer you an appointment as ambulance director effective March 21st, 2016, at the current stipend of $6,260 a year. The appointment would be pending a pre-employment physical, completion of an I-9 form, and the acceptance of the offer. Please speak.
Second, maybe?
Second, yeah. Second. All in favor?
Yeah, sorry, yeah.
All right. Okay. Tell us about yourself, Jim.
Not much to tell. I mean, I've lived in Conway my whole life, which is 30 years as of last fall, and I've been on the fire department for almost 15 years and the ambulance for almost seven years.
So you're very familiar with the operation of the ambulance department?
For the most part, yeah.
Right.
I mean, there's obviously some paperwork side of stuff I still have to learn from Jody and whatnot.
Well, Jody will be staying on with you for a while to get through that.
Yeah, we kind of started going over some different paperwork already just so I could be a little more prepared if and when this came to fruition.
Okay. And as you and Jody progress, please come to us with any recommendations you might have to do things in the ambulance department that you think would be good for the whole operation. Any other questions for Jen?
Yeah, I got not a question, but we've had a general discussion in the interviewing process with her, and she has a big, big task ahead of her, which is trying to find more EMTs to join the squads.
Yeah.
And that's an ongoing problem in all the communities, not just Conway. And I think she maybe I hope some good ideas, maybe.
Good.
I'm working on it. I'm open to any and all suggestions from anybody.
The only other thing I got, John, is on,
we
on,
all
this,
need help.
On this financial stipend of hers, how does that work? When is Jody paid to the end of the fiscal year?
Jody will be paid for what she does, and Gemma will be paid for what she does.
And they do have money to cover that.
They do have money. Okay.
Yes.
That's my question. Do you want any bouncing budgets? We don't want to grow in a deficit budget.
Okay. Any questions you have for us, Gemma? At this time?
I don't think at this point. I'm assuming that I just want to clarify that I would still be paid my regular rate on calls, for transport calls, and then the stipend is separate, or is it all kind of rolled into one thing?
They are separate.
Okay.
They are separate. Right. In past practice, the animal instructor has gotten paid for runs.
Okay, that's
over and above their salary.
Okay.
Am I correct in saying that?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. That was pretty much the only kind of gray area I wasn't sure on. Mm-hmm. I hadn't gotten clarification from Jody about it.
Do you know what the rate for the EMTs is?
16 or 17, something an hour, I think. I don't know for sure. I don't usually. I just pay it, turn in my payroll to Jody, get the check, put it in the bank, and don't really. It's definitely not a.
I think
money making proposition. Right.
You'll have to set that up with your payroll up with Jan, I guess, right?
Yes. Yeah.
All okay. That. Well, do you get that every other week or?
Okay.
Like I get it every 2 weeks, my stipend. So.
Okay.
It's cut out a year for every 2 weeks.
Okay. Right.
We can talk about that also.
Figure that out with you guys at some point.
You guys can figure that out.
Yeah, talk to Tom about that.
Yeah. And I'll send the offer right now.
Okay.
Right.
Thanks for coming in, Jen.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Thanks, Jen. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Congratulations. We wish you congratulations.
And we'll see you more often now.
All right. Yep, I'll be around. Okay. I mean, I'm up at Orchard all the time, so come visit.
Great.
Thank you. See you. Have a good night.
You too.
Next up. Dana.
Good evening. Well, this was sweet. He had a tough morning, I'd have to say.
It was a tough morning.
It was a tough morning, period.
Yeah.
Yeah, he lost a truck right up in front of my house.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. Lost two rear wheels on it. Not wheels, the tires went. I'm sure that was no fun getting those
tires blew or something.
Yeah. Well, I think what happened, lost the outboard tire, and then of course when it was a full load of salt on, it was just pushing a tire.
Which truck was that?
The Ford, the yellow Ford.
Oh, the yellow Ford.
Yeah.
Oh, the newest one we bought.
Yeah, that had to be. I just couldn't imagine changing a tire in rain.
Oh, yeah, golly.
Okay. Things can happen.
Goodness.
Yeah. You have an update for us, Dana?
Yeah. I guess I could go through the capital requests. You know, the school stabilization fund, that's a given. The stabilization funds, or the funds for the stabilization account, That's a given, there's no question about that. Then we get into the sticky stuff. There wasn't much positive thought about paving the back of this building. And the consensus seemed to be, and correct me if I'm wrong on this, but is this building, the office is going to get moved across? Is that the plan?
Well, that's the eventual plan, but...
Is there a timeline on that, or...?
Not at this point, no. No.
All right. Well, there was that issue. The other issue that came up, Russ French had a good point, that paving that area out there, what's that going to do for water? Like, if we had rain the way we did today, is that going to go onto an abutter's property, or, you know... He thought, felt some thought.
Well, when did the paving of the back come up? This is the first time I'm hearing this.
Well, Tom had a request.
About a month ago?
Yeah, this is one of the things that I proposed.
That he proposed.
And it's it'd be about $10,000. And you'll notice that there's a pool in the back there.
Mm-hmm.
And it happens when you plow, you know, and he is Ron is in the spring planning to bring some of the material that has been plowed, bring it back over the garage. But right now, it keeps getting torn up and brought back. Right. It's hard to keep as
as nothing
stable.
You could do about it now.
Service.
Yeah.
An additional concern there is that the leach field for the septic for this building is
in the parking lot.
Well, it's in one end of it.
Well, that's a definite concern. So you can pave over a leach field.
We wouldn't be paving. We probably wouldn't be paving over the leach field part of it, but that's mostly where the grapevines were growing in front of the cars. We're not exactly sure where it is. The diagrams may not be perfect.
How do you deal with that water issue on blacktop is a difficult thing because the whole thing pitches that way, and we don't own anything past the parking lot.
Yeah.
It's all private land all the way around that.
Well, the concern was gravel around the edges or whatever we had to do, but it's actually not good to walk on right now, even to walk on, let alone drive on, because it gets ripped up so much.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't consider it a safe surface at this point. Which is what brought it to my attention, aside from it being inconvenient with the pooling. And
well, it's been that service for how many years?
Ever since
we've been in here, in this building.
Yeah. Well, repairing the surface, bring some gravel in and roll it out and fill up the low spots.
It's not my highest priority.
Okay, that's good. Yeah. That's easy.
But it's also not that expensive.
Yeah. Well, 10 grand is 10 grand, and you're going to find that my committee is very sensitive to money, and we don't look at 10 grand as a tuppence.
I think the thing, you know, the. I think the ideal is for the Capital Improvement Planning Committee to prioritize what needs to be done.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, so you have now a request and you know that it's out there and it's a possibility. So, you know, you look at the merits of each of the cases and all of that sort of thing. The Finance Committee will be the first to tell you that there's not enough money to do it. And as far as the priority goes, it is... It's not my top priority, but I thought I'd put it on the list because, you know, in 5 years when it comes up, then I can say it's been on the list for 5 years and haven't done anything.
They say in the game of golf, never up, never in. So.
Yeah.
We'll consider your request to be on the green.
Well, one of the things that came up was Ms. Greenwood and the Reed House, if there was... Is that going to change? Is it going to throw all that water over into their yards and
that's towards the leach field. So the reeds are not as affected by that.
Yeah.
And you know, getting some gravel in there for drainage would be a good thing. And if we pitched it towards that, then you know we're not overly inconveniencing the neighbors. That sort of thing.
Any other major?
Yeah, we don't need to beat that one to death. We'll move along. There wasn't much appetite for Ron Sweet's portable lift. That's a $50,000 ride. Are you aware of that one?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. We didn't feel that that was something that should be prioritized. And again, I mean, we're looking at things from the information we've received that we're in some pretty tight financial straits here. I mean, we're looking at 2.5% rate increase for taxes.
That could be.
You've heard that, yeah. Well, again,
I hope that's coming down, but...
Pardon?
I hope that's coming down, but...
Well, I would hope so,
I'm still in a nervous mode at this point.
Well, I'm glad. We're not alone. I guess that's what I meant to say. We're very concerned about that. And we just felt that, you know, that was something that hopefully someday we're going to have a town garage.
Mm-hmm.
And that will negate the necessity for that. The last item was the biggie, Bob's fire truck. We had some real questions on that one. The $300,000 coming out of capitalization, when did that ever get put in? Nobody could ever remember any money being voted into stabilization account for the fire department.
No. It is not in there specifically for the fire truck. what's on the schedule that was in the binder is a list of just money that goes in and then the vehicles and a schedule for them being replaced. Mm-hmm. So with that, right now, the Capital Stabilization Fund is supposed to cover all of the vehicles. One of the problems is that it really should also be covering the buildings and their major systems. But it is within the capital stabilization, all of the vehicles are meant to come out of it.
Well, and we might as well jump right to this since we're touching on it anyway. We feel that there should be capital stabilization fund for highway vehicles, fire department vehicles, and maybe not so much for police department, because you're talking, by comparison, a much less expensive vehicle than anything the other two departments. But I guess, whether we're correct in our thinking or not, our aim is to try and level these things out so that all of a sudden we don't go into a town meeting looking at what at the time we thought was a $500,000, and after I talked with Bob yesterday, I guess it's closer probably to $400,000. Still a big chunk of money. Mm-hmm. And it would be nice if 3 or 5 years ago we had said, okay, 5 years from now, we're going to have to buy a fire truck. We know they are expensive. Let's start putting 50, 75, whatever, a year into a stabilization fund. And the same thing with the highway department, because I think, is it 2017 or 18, Ron will be looking for a truck, and I can promise you by that time you're going to be spoiling the biggest chunk of $200,000.
Mm-hmm. Well, again, that is the purpose of the planning committee, is to make sure that we don't have any surprises down the road.
We had talked 5 years ago about, at least when myself as fire chief and the select boards, and talked about replacing 5 years ago, getting ready to replace the fire truck. And money was appropriate every year and put in it, but evidently it was never earmarked for anything for a fire truck. They knew that and talked about it for the last 5 years, mm-hmm. and we did appropriate money every year toward the stabilization mm-hmm. account.
Yeah. And it has been on the schedule as the next major piece of equipment mm-hmm. to be bought with capital stabilization fund.
I guess, do we have a copy of that schedule?
Yes, it should be in the binder. That
I don't recall seeing that. I'll have to look at that further.
And of course, part of the problem was that 5 years ago, the trucks cost $300,000. So that's what the target had been, and you know, getting up that extra $100,000.
The unfortunate thing that I saw with that list of replacement equipment a couple of years ago, that got all rearranged. It was mm-hmm. on a set plan for the last 10 to 15 years for vehicle replacement. All the department heads, including the highway and fire, had, and I think the police cruiser was probably even in there too.
Yeah. Yeah.
Was was kind of laid out as to what, how much into the life of the vehicle should it be replaced. Mm-hmm. And this whole scale was built up. And then 2 to 3 years ago, for some reason, I have no idea how it happened, all these things got twisted and turned around and replayed and put in different spots. I don't know how that ever took place, but it did. Because that fire truck was supposed to have been replaced last year.
Yeah.
That was estimated to be replaced on its 25th year. And now we're in the 26th year.
Well, since the meeting, let me preface my remarks by, since the meeting, I met with Bob yesterday because I really needed to one-on-one get some information about this truck, because sitting in a committee, we don't know what the truck needs to be. I mean, all you see is this expensive truck and, oh my God, a five-man cab. This is the town of Conway. Do we need a five-man cab? That's a custom-built truck compared to what we were thinking was a conventional, what they call commercial chassis, which would be a chassis similar to what you'd have for a town truck with no body or anything on it, and make it into a fire truck, which would be a lot less money. But that doesn't serve the purpose. And ironically, I don't know if it was last week, I think, there was an article in the Greenfield Recorder about mutual aid and mm-hmm. how the mutual aid, I think you probably all read it, and mm-hmm. the problem of getting crews to a fire. So you can't send three trucks from Conway just to get everybody there. That doesn't make any sense either. So most of the ideas that we had in our last meeting, I would have to say, are probably pointless. Mm-hmm. It's just not going to work. So we're faced with what Bob is looking for. That being said, I don't know how the hell we're going to pay for it. Short of going out, borrowing money. Again, we're thinking about the impact on tax rates and so mm-hmm. forth.
Sure. Well, we do have money in stabilization, part of which we can use for that.
How much money is in the stabilization, totally?
Well, the capital has got $423,109.
And that's where it would come out of?
And the general stabilization, which yeah. some could come out of that too, it's got $395,706 for a total of $818,816. Right, so that according to the update as of tonight in this
book. Yeah, there's plenty of money in stabilization.
Let me jump into one more thing and then we can come back to it. I think it would be very beneficial if we could get and it's got to be a real no-brainer, it's really easy, to get a printout of the balance of all the accounts in
the town. Right out of this book.
Tom has that information.
Yeah, it's in here. We can copy it.
I think that would be a big help, because if we saw that there was that kind of money, I'm sure there would have been a lot less shaking of heads.
Well, didn't you meet with the finance committee at all?
Unfortunately, our finance member hasn't been there.
Yeah, he's missed our meeting so far.
Okay.
That can happen, right?
Yeah.
But right, well, you should coordinate with them because they have all those numbers too. Yeah.
And Tom can give it to her.
I have all.
All right. All I mean, it's got to be a real simple thing. I mean, mm-hmm. I know.
Gets updated every month. So.
Yeah. Okay. So that being said, I mean, it changes, I'm sure, and I speaking now for the rest of the committee, they don't know any of this. That's probably going to change our outlook on mm-hmm. on how we do this. Now, one of the things that we probably ought to think about, and this is not our realm really, but Bob told me that some of these companies, if you prepay a portion of the total amount, they will reduce the price. And I think one company was, what, a 50%? They take $20,000
off. $27,000 off.
Yeah. Well, but I don't have to tell.
That company at this point is not the company that we've been communicating with because they backed out of.
Well, you know what? These are all bargaining chips. You know?
Yeah. I think I got a call into this company that we've been working with now. And that will be our next question to him when he comes back with we've adjusted the figures down.
I mean, our money is not making us any money. No. I don't care where it's invested. It's
that's
not.
Right. That's
yeah, right. Right.
And if you can take that money and chop $20,000, you know, that's 5% on a $400,000 fire truck. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I don't think we're getting anywhere near 5% on anything.
Well, we'll have to run that past the Department of Revenue.
Right.
Tom.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Well, I'll run by Joyce.
Yeah.
Joyce will know.
Yeah.
Okay. Great.
Good. Okay.
Thank you, Dana.
All right.
Thanks for coming.
Thanks, Dana.
No, thank you.
And did the committee? We were talking about we couldn't deliberate on anything, but did we decide that all of us could get together and go look around at things?
Well, we're still waiting for that invitation.
Oh, okay. All right.
Yes, we'd like to go look at the fire trucks of the town.
I know we discussed about sometime this week, maybe.
Nobody wants to see the police cruiser. I don't know why.
Pony inside.
Yeah. And I'll note that I've reached out to Dana and Jim Bosman at the Finance Committee. Jan and Joyce, Jan and Lee, and I think it would be great to get all of the financial people, a sort of a larger financial team, together to work on some long-term financial policies for the town. Some of the things that will help everybody understand the way everybody else thinks and have common goals, mm-hmm. In terms of the normal way that the town should do things, and then if we deviate from that, at least we know we're deviating from a plan that we want to get back to. I've thought that Joe Markarian from DOR would be a really good resource person for that.
He's at FERCOG now.
Part-time, because he's mm-hmm. retired.
Yeah.
But I've sent a little feeler out to him to see if he might be interested in helping, because he would be a wizard facilitating a meeting like
that. At our meetings at FERCOG, he's willing to come out and talk to the town. So
that'd
be
great.
Call him
that'd
up.
Be good.
Yeah.
That would be good.
I'm aiming for something like September. I figure we need to get through this season and through town meeting and the post-town meeting rush, and then everybody's away for the summer, so I was thinking, as we gear up for the next fiscal year, getting on the same page would help.
One quick question before I go. Did you get a check from Dillon's for the truck?
Dillon's. I did not get a check from Dillon's. It could have gone to the treasurer.
Okay. I'll follow up with her on that.
Thanks, Dana.
Thank you, Dana.
Thank you for lining that pickup up and getting the auction.
That was great.
Appreciate it.
Good
price.
Thank you.
Yeah. Very good. Thanks, Dana.
Yeah. All right, next item on the agenda, we have appointments to the 250th Anniversary Committee with terms ending June 30th, 2016. We have Amanda Pollack, Nancy Bovio, and Richard Paulette. I'll make a motion that we approve the appointments of these three individuals to the 250th Anniversary Committee.
Second.
I have a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And I noticed Adam's name is scratched off. Did he decide not?
We already reappointed him.
Well, you know, I was thinking that.
Last time.
I was thinking.
He's new on there.
Okay, good.
All right. He's all set for this year. Yeah.
All right, next item on the agenda is to sign the warrant for the state and federal primary elections. That's going to be March 1st, 2016. I'll make a motion that we approve the warrant for the state and federal primary elections.
Second.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay.
I want us to be able to vote.
Absolutely. Next item on the agenda is to approve the warrant for the annual Citizens Caucus to be held at Town Hall on Monday, March 7th at 8 p.m. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay.
Next item on the agenda is for the fire department, fire chief, and hourly pay for call-outs.
That's Tom, my item.
Yeah. Why don't we have Don look into that as part of his recommendations?
Well, the issue now is that there's internal inequity in town. And it's not so much of whether it happens in other towns, but we have the ambulance department, and
I will just say for the record that I believe I heard Bob recuse himself from this conversation.
Yes, you have. By all means.
That the ambulance department does have that situation, mm-hmm. Where there's a stipend plus call out for the director of that department. The fire department does not have the same deal where the stipend is also supplemented by hourly call out pay. Mm-hmm. And
that's been going on for quite a long time? Forever.
I believe I heard when the ambulance directors started that, and it was, I think, before Randy was ambulance director. I wouldn't put it as forever, but probably 10 years, on the order of 8 to 10 years, something like that. I don't believe, for the amount of money that it would represent, I don't believe it's a fiscal concern.
You think it's a policy concern?
Yes. And rather than having different departments treated differently, I think it would help the town to have a consistent policy. Now, we did just affirm to Gemma that they were paid separately. Mm-hmm. And I think she did have that expectation when she apply for the position, and that's, you know, it would be difficult to take something away from her. So I would suggest that the board broaden that policy to include the fire chief.
Okay. Now, when is that going to start?
That would be the next fiscal year.
Next fiscal year. Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
And if you want to chew on that a little bit, and you know, we can talk with Don about it next time too, but I thought I'd put it out there just as a recommendation to you for now.
When Don comes next time, mm-hmm. come to us with a written recommendation on that.
Okay. Okay, will do.
All right, next item on the agenda, any items not anticipated in 48 hours in advance of the meeting?
Well, actually, if we can back up just a little bit, I did have something on the budget.
Okay.
Just a little bit of an update. There's probably an extra one there. It's supposed to be for this. Is it four? Yeah,
there it is.
If there's an extra, I can just stick that on this desk. Yeah. So this is going to be what I present as the expenses. Not all of them are locked in stone at this point, but I'm trying to bring you a balanced budget. With the information I have now and with the understanding that this is going to change as you and the Finance Committee look at everything.
Mm-hmm.
Also right now, this does not include any potential salary pay raise for anybody.
Right.
It does include the Highway Department supervisor getting the extra dollar an hour for taking over building maintenance.
Right.
The audit has gone up, 135 has gone up to 15.5 because we need that extra end of year audit. Normally it would be 13,000.
Right.
He's paying both of those.
$2,500, right.
The information technology, you know, I put it in as 20,000, that's what it'll cost. There was a certain amount that was coming from my budget for that.
Mm-hmm.
And I could have sort of reduced it by that amount, but this is the amount that's going to be in that line item. So I thought that it was best to have that line item showing what it was actually. I mean, I could have said, you know, it's a $15,000 increase or something
like
that.
Right.
But yeah.
So yours will adjust down.
It doesn't. Well, just in the change from the last column, the change from fiscal year 16 to 17. That could be 15,000, but the way that it worked out with my budget, I think this is just simpler, and we can work more on that if you want me to. But I thought I'd mention it.
The increase in the school budgets is due primarily to insurance increases.
Insurance and retirements from Frontier, which account for something like $125,000. for the whole district. And of course, Deerfield carries most of the weight for that, but it does reflect. I'm hoping that I estimated the town insurance jump high. I don't have final figures on that yet. Non-school things, again, the change in the highway department is out of that $7,000, $6,250 is the proposed 8-hour clerk, who would also be doing building maintenance.
Right.
Clerk handyman. The COG actually came in, as I mentioned before, $47 over that estimate, which has bumped it up to $2,000. So that's very close.
Right.
So for the purposes of this budget, I'm not... Everything else is already figured out in the document, so I don't want to screw around with it too much. But I did also, just one more time, want to point out the 300A line grammar school operating, the 320 technical schools, and the 892A frontier. Together, those are $158,674.
Yep.
Now, if you take that out of the $270,000 that the budget's going up on the town side of the budget, which includes the COG, it includes other regional things, but it's the not the school, everything except the schools would be going up about $112,000.
About 2%.
Which is 2.13%.
Yeah.
And that's not unreasonable. It looks really bad because of how the schools are. And so we end up with a little over a 5% increase.
Mm-hmm.
Again, averaged over last year, it was only a 1.4% increase.
Schools represent basically 3% of it.
If you average it out over 3 years, it comes out to be very even over the last 3 years, but unfortunately, this is a difficult year.
Yeah.
So I just wanted to reiterate that point on the budget.
Okay.
For the human resources, you get the packet. Bob has already found something that needs to be tweaked. If anybody else does, please let me know. Don should be coming in next week with the whole proposal. And he will have a proposal not just to, look at, to tell you how he arrived at these levels of responsibility and then looking at the other towns for comparable pay, but he has a plan for compensation management that is a little complex. Shelburne likes it.
Mm-hmm.
At least one person in Shelburne. I'm sure a number of people in Shelburne like it.
Yeah.
So it's not a simple proposal, and it we're not necessarily looking for a decision next week, but the more you can look at the materials, the fewer questions, if you have questions, send them to me or to him, and we can get a lot of that out of the way, and we can move, I think, very close to some kind of a resolution next week.
Okay.
I don't have any change in town meeting warrant items so far. There's nothing changed from last week.
All right. You have an update for us, another update, or is that pretty much it?
This is what I've been spending my time on.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
I almost have the budget document for you, but I want to do one more major tweak before I get it to you, so that should be there next week.
Okay. Any concerns of our selectmen? Okay. All right, our next meeting is scheduled for February the 22nd. That's Monday at 7 o'clock here in the town offices. Right now, I'll call for a roll call vote to go into executive session. I vote aye.
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 Aye, okay.
And that would be under reason number three, because you're declared.
Yes. Under reason number three, to discuss strategy with respect to litigation if an open meeting may have a detrimental effect on the litigating position of the public body.